It's a lovely morning, and of course, this is Joy FM Radio, a station meant for your ears only. We are back once again with your favorite program, The Platform. Today, we are discussing MMD's wish list for power, and we have in the studios MMD President Dr. Nevers Sekwila Mumba. And of course, before we go in the details of the program, we just take a look at eight wise proverbs from our forefathers in Africa. The first one says, learning expands great souls. This other one says, to get lost is to learn the way. If you close your eyes to facts, you will learn through accidents. That's all those are wise words from our forefathers in Africa. This other one says, wealth, if you use it, comes to an end. Learning, if you use it, increases. By trying often, the monkey learns to jump from the tree. You always learn a lot more when you lose than when you win. These other two says, you learn how to cut down trees by cutting them down. And the last one says, the wise create proverbs for fools to learn, not to repeat. So in the studios once again, I have with me Dr. Nevers Sekwila Mumba, who is MMD president, and we'll be discussing the MMD's wish list for power on the other side of this.
This is The Platform Program with Kunda Kunda.
Dr. Mumba, good morning and welcome to Joy FM.
Kunda Kunda, good morning, and to our listeners across the city and wherever this station reaches, I wish each one of you a wonderful, wonderful day, and may the Lord bless us, and I look forward to a very engaging discussion this morning.
The last time you were here, you and I were in trouble.
Well, I've always known that you're a troublemaker, but I'm sure that the circumstances in our nation demand that we face the challenges head on in order for us to find a solution for our people across this country. So I think you're doing your job, and I was doing my job as opposition leader, so I think that that comes with the territory.
Yes, that's right. To begin with, I think I have never asked you this question. I would like to know, why do you want to become Republican president of Zambia?
One of the first things is that I want to change politics. Since independence, we have changed governments over and over again. But this time, I think time has come for us to change politics. Serving as a minister of the gospel for close to 33 years, and having served as ambassador to Canada, having served as vice president of the republic, I have concluded that the equitable delivery of goods and services to any people depends on the integrity and the morality of its leaders. Mm-hmm. And I know that with my background and the things that we have done in this nation, what Zambia needs today are not just people who promise good things, like we were promised in 2011, people who claim to be highly educated because they got a certain certificate or degree in a specific discipline, or people who feel that they understand the politics of buying people and lying to people. That's the type of leadership that we have seen for the most part in our country and most African countries. The season has come, if we want to see development in our country and on the continent as well, to start to invest in leadership of morality and integrity. I believe that with my leadership as President of the Republic, the Zambians are looking at a well-shaped and prepared person, firstly in the management of people. As a pastor for 30 years, my job has been to make sure that we mitigate the needs of the poor, cry with those who are crying, lift the standards of living for those people that don't have a voice. Serving as an ambassador helped me very much to understand how to engage Zambia globally and to become a participant in global economics and also global investments. Serving as vice president gives me the political acumen to understand what is at stake in making sure that every Zambian benefits from the national cake
But couldn't you have achieved all those from the pulpit?
Well, as you have noticed, I've added from the pulpit, I've added the diplomatic touch to my leadership. I've added vice presidency, which is the governance of this country. And I think when you go to look for a job, one of the things they ask you is, give us your experience. Mm-hmm. And I think that when you look at the experience that I've already articulated to you, I think that it gives you a well-rounded leadership candidate in terms of having a pastoral heart to ensure that what he says is what he means. And I think that Zambia has lacked in this regard in terms of public policy. And one of the reasons I joined the political process, basically, is that Zambian people deserve to be told the truth, and they deserve to be loved. They deserve to be consulted on matters that concern them. And I think a pastor understands that. But I also think that a diplomat understands that we are not an island. In order for our economy to grow, in order for us to receive international respect, we have to find a way to engage the international community in a respectable and progressive manner. I have never said this before, but my stint in Canada as High Commissioner opened up opportunities for this country that we had never seen from that country. An investment of about $8 billion when I was High Commissioner was invested in this country through continuous negotiation. That's how Barrick Gold Lumwana mine was bought and opened. While I was there, I was identified as the first president of the entire diplomatic community in Canada, the first African, and that thing fell on Zambia. And so basically, I think that on the international scene, we do have what it takes to ensure that we represent our country well. And finally, of course, the vice presidency, which gave me an opportunity to go across this country, talk to the grassroots, find out what the problems of the Zambians are, and be able to translate them into policy positions of government. So I think we are ready to fight this fight. We are ready to provide the leadership. And of course, leadership comes from God. So we all have to depend on the fact that when that time comes, the time comes from God.
Any challenges in your quest for power, quickly, before we touch the pertinent issues of the program?
Yeah, let me say that for me, my involvement in politics is very different from a lot of my colleagues who have entered politics maybe as a profession or as a job. I come into politics from a position of being called and feeling that God wants me to participate in the process. But the challenges that are faced, obviously, is that this territory of politics has already been claimed by the so-called people who consider themselves non-religious. And I'm using that word in a very careful manner. For me, being a minister of the gospel and a pastor, the fight I fight is that how can a pastor become a president? Some of them have even gone to an extreme of saying that Dr. Mumba has left the pulpit for politics, not to understand that basically I am in politics because of the pulpit, because of my love for God, my commitment to God, and I cannot abandon God when I need him the most, and this is now. Because we need godly policy positions, we need godly unity that can be based on godly values. And so I think that I have faced the challenge of perception, for instance. A lot of people, when they look at a pastor, they have already judged the pastor, that the pastor doesn't understand, for instance, economics. You've heard some people say that Nevers cannot guide the economic policies of this country. But if we go into my history, a lot of people are going to discover that the economic understanding that I have, or the studies I've done, or the degree I have in global economics, is even higher than some of the people that are not church people. But because I'm a church person, they think that a church person only knows how to preach. And they look at us like a people that do not understand. And yet God gave me an opportunity to go to one of the best schools in this country, Hillcrest Technical Secondary School. There were only two schools at the time that I went there that had that kind of rating. And from there that, assumed higher educational qualifications, including a master's degree in public policy and governance from one of the best universities in the United States, which is Regent University. And so, but because of being a preacher and being a church person and being a Christian, people look down on you because the history they have of Christians is that of people that don't understand policy, they don't understand anything, and I think it's an insult to the church, and it's insult to the profession of those who preach the gospel. And I think that by now Zambians know that you know, you cannot ever again look down on a child of God on the basis of your stereotype thinking.
Okay, now we are looking at issues to do with governance. My first question is, what greatly displeases you about the current governance system that we have as a nation?
There are many things, but maybe let me start with what I've already touched, mm-hmm. and that is dishonesty. I think that the biggest problem that our country faces is a moral problem. It's an integrity problem. It is a character problem. And unfortunately for us as a nation and as a continent, these are values we don't look at when we are choosing leadership. We follow what I call winds. When there's a wind, like there was a don't kubeba wind, people who are extremely educated but lazy to think and to analyze the situation went ahead and voted for the wind. And because the wind was blowing so much, preachers, pastors, businessmen, marketeers, professionals, civil servants decided to follow the wind and vote for the wind. And when you sow to the wind, you reap the wind. So we are reaping the wind now because we didn't care about any common sense. We didn't care about any questions about morality and integrity being asked. All we wanted was a wind has come and we have to vote for the wind. My prayer is that as we move forward to the next election, there are going to be more resilient men and women that are not going to follow these wind politicians, artificially created winds, either maybe managed by resource or money, and they use money to create a momentum, and people vote for a momentum created by money. So I think I'm concerned that the Patriotic Front, for instance, came into government on a set of promises to the Zambian people. Unfortunately for our colleagues, they gave a 90-day window in which they were going to achieve certain amazing feats, including that of the delivery of the constitution to the Zambian people, including that of the provision of jobs to our young people, including the one of putting money in people's pockets within 90 days. And obviously, Zambians are a Christian people, and they somehow believed that a leader cannot stand on the platform and lie blatantly to them. And they voted for the Patriotic Front. Now we are in the third year of them being in government, and the promises that were made are not an issue to the Patriotic Front. They don't even feel any sting within their conscience to stop for a moment and say, wait a minute, we made a promise and we want to talk to Zambians to forgive us for having failed to do that, and explain to the Zambians that we were not able to achieve this because of ABCD. That lack of respect for the electorate, that lack of acknowledgement that lying is immoral and lying is not part of a leadership trait or should not be, that concerns me. It annoys me, actually. It annoys me to see leaders going ahead without being accountable for what they have promised. So I think that at this particular point, the answer to Zambian politics is not just another flying politician with money in all his pockets and with some kind of line that he's using, a mantra that he's using of don't kubeba or more money in your pockets, but a leader with a proven background, a leader that can be relied on, and what they say is what they mean. And I believe today, more than any other time, that Zambia is now mature and has a lot of people across its expanse that are a moral people, that are not going to vote for the wind this time. They are going to have a heart that is going to be still and say, in choosing a leader, we are choosing the future for our children. We are choosing integrity for our state. We are choosing global representation that will make our country a country that people would like to come to. So I think that I'm concerned about the lies in the politics. I'm concerned at the vindictiveness in the politics. I'm concerned about the disunity that is brought about by the people in government. And I'm concerned that there is no concern to have a moral people in leadership on the part of a lot of groupings, including some media houses.
Okay, so now specifically when we talk of governance, there are three wings of governance. We're talking of parliament, the judiciary, and of course the executive. How will you ensure that these three arms of government run professionally and provide the needed checks and balances to each other?
Very briefly. Again, please don't get tired of hearing the same sentence I'm making, because I believe this is the basis for successful government. The reason why you hear speeches from politicians that promise you, when I become president, I shall respect the separation of powers, amongst the three wings of government. The judiciary, that is the legislature, and the executive. Everybody says that. But what distinguishes leaders from the one who's going to achieve that and the one who is just using it to get votes? It's the same message I'm giving: morality and integrity of leadership. Now, some of the people may get confused. Nevers, what do you mean by morality? How do you know someone is moral and his morality is real? Morality is a godly virtue. It's a virtue in the heart of somebody who honors God, somebody who fears some deity, knows that he cannot just promise and not do it. He cannot just make a statement and throw it on the shelf. But the conscience of a person who knows God haunts him at night when he makes a promise and doesn't fulfill it. So I think that to fulfill the respect of the three wings of government still demands the leadership, a leadership of morality. And this is what the New Hope MMD wants to provide in the next government: to ensure that we invest in good leaders, we invest in moral leaders, we invest in leaders with integrity, and start a new process where we have now stopped just changing governments. But now we come to the most important thing, and that is to change politics. So I am committed, together with my colleagues in the New Hope MMD, that once elected into office, the three wings of government are going to be respectedly separated. Why? Because it will work in the interest of the Zambian people. It is wrong, it is immoral for a government to interfere in the two wings of government, because those are the basis of a democratic dispensation. That is what democracy really breathes on. So if you remove their independence, you collapse the very spirit of democracy. And so, I don't think a president should wake up one day to manipulate the speaker in order to get his way just because he thinks he's a president. If a president wants a bill to pass in the House, the president should do what American presidents do. They begin to persuade their population to advance their views, intelligently debate. Don't use money, don't use threats, don't twist arms. Just use your intelligence of debate with the nation so that your point of view can be accepted. With the judiciary, which is the most abused in many African countries, including ours, is that the president or his executive sometimes, they find liberty to interfere, especially that the appointments come from the presidency. So this is why later on we're going to talk about the constitution to cure that particular thing. But I think that for me, as president, my commitment is going to ensure that the three wings of government are not cadarized by cadaism, but they are independent in order to provide the necessary checks and balances, which in return are going to encourage the international community to respect Zambia and to improve the traffic of investment in our country. Because when they see these three wings of government operating well, the international community wants to get involved. They feel that that country is stable. They feel that their business endeavors are going to be protected. So my commitment to the Zambian people is that, based on my history, which the Bible says you shall know them by their fruit, and the fruit is to ensure that morality and integrity of being truthful guides my leadership as president, I'll make sure that parliament operates independently, I'll make sure the judiciary operates independently, and I'll make sure that the executive oversees the affairs of state with fear and trembling, knowing that we are placed there by people and God.
How do you rate President Sata's performance in relation to the respect of the separation of powers of the three arms of government?
I think the challenge that any executive is going to have you know, deals with the choice of individuals that you put in those positions. Except for Parliament, where the Speaker is voted in by the members of Parliament themselves, the judiciary has a challenge that the President is the appointing authority. Of course, Parliament ratifies the judges. And so we always have to be aware, and I think this is the right time for me to talk about this, in terms of how well has the President performed. I think that once you are appointing almost everybody, the constitutional officers that are appointed by the President across the country, and also the power of a President to move down from State House to be able to fire a director in the Ministry of Finance or the Ministry of Home Affairs or the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, has created, for instance, in our country, such fear that even professional people who are supposed to carry out their jobs in favor of an ordinary Zambian, they are afraid of losing their jobs if they don't toe the line. And I think that Zambia right now, as I speak, is under great hypnosis of fear. It's not just the ordinary Zambian, but even State House, even the President is afraid. He doesn't know whether Nevers Mumba means well, the opposition mean well. So what the government of PF has done is to ensure that Nevers Mumba and his colleagues in the opposition are not given an opportunity to even hold meetings, to stifle our freedoms of expression and association and assembly. That is a fearful State House. It's a fearful government. And because the government is fearful, then you notice that you move into a country that is gripped with fear. Businessmen are afraid even to support the, you know, any party that is not in government, because they say that they're going to lose their businesses, then they're going to lose their contracts. Some pastors are fearful because they think that their churches are going to be affected by what they call the system. Then we go to some media houses that are so fearful that they cannot even report on an opposition leader because they are afraid that either they will lose their license or they are going to lose their popularity or something like that. Everyone is gripped by fear. One of my first acts in government is what I did when I took over the MMD. I pronounced, "Don't kutina, fear not, don't be afraid." The first spell that needs to be broken in this country is the spell of fear and intimidation. Out of freedom, like Roosevelt said, the greatest fear that we have is fear itself, because fear holds you back from becoming what God has intended for you to become. And therefore, it is the reason why I have never carried fear in my heart. If I believe what is, this is good for me, it's good for the country, I'll fight for it, whether it ends me in jail or anywhere else. And I think that Zambia is fearful, and because of that fear, the performance of the PF has been dismal, because people cannot perform at their optimum. They can't perform professionally. They can't perform with all their hearts because they are gripped with fear. My first act as President is to break this fear and set the Zambians free.
Okay, now we take a look at the police. You hinted a bit how you are hindered from meeting with fellow people, fellow leaders, and of course supporters. Why do we have a police which is so politicized?
Again, I said in the beginning that we have changed politics since 1964. Under the new Hope MMD, when we get back into government, we are going to change politics, the way politics is conducted and done. The police can be likened to, maybe let me liken the whole process to maybe a dog. I'm not calling the police dogs, but I'm just talking about the system being a dog. And the police could be the tail. Now, the tail is controlled from the head of the dog. And, you know, whatever the head does, that's what the tail does. And so we have a situation that if the head is not secure in itself, is not comfortable in its shoes and its outfit, that they are doing what they promised the Zambian people, they are delivering goods and services, the Zambians are happy. If the government feels insufficient and inadequate, they are going to manipulate the movement of the tail, which is the police. And unfortunately, police people are just also employees. They live to feed their families by the salaries they get from being policemen. So if a government is brutal in the way that they want to enforce their control over the state, then the police have no option but to sing the song. And whichever police person, a policeman, decides to go contrary to what that dictate from the government is, they are going to fire that person. But I think time has come for us to look at those heroes, policemen and women, who tender in their resignation that their conscience is being invaded, their conscience is being compromised, and they cannot work under a circumstance like that. But very few Zambian policemen are able to afford that because they don't have means, no businesses, no other means to look after their family. So I think the police are a victim of a hostile environment in which they operate, and coming back into government as the New Hope MMD, again, our act will be to ensure that the professional police begin to operate in this country again, where they can even come and apprehend a minister if he's going wrong, without the president moving in to say that you have to first talk to me about touching the minister. Because if you break the law, only the president is above the law, and to that extent, in inverted commas. But everybody else, if they break the law, the police should not be intimidated to take action. And I think that our government, as we get back into government, is going to show for the first time that you can govern yourselves with respect, you can govern yourselves without fear, you can govern yourselves with progress of wanting to develop the country instead of intimidating your friends.
Well, in case you're just joining us in the studios, I have with me MMD President Dr. Nevers Sekwila Mumba, and of course we are discussing the MMD's wish list for power. And now, let's take a look at a constitution. In your own view, do you feel we need a new constitution? I think we have heard statements recently from senior members of the PF party that we still have a functional constitution. What is the rush?
Kunda, the question you've asked is a little bit misleading when you said, do you think we need, you, Nevers Mumba, need a constitution? I think this is not about Nevers Mumba. I think the Zambian
I mean, as a country.
Yeah, I think the Zambian
think we
people.
Need a new constitution.
I think the Zambian people for many years have realized that they need a constitution that shall represent their current aspirations as a people. I mean, some of the legislation that we have in our current constitution comes from the 40s, I mean, from the British time, and they don't really represent where we are today. They don't even represent our democratic culture that we've embraced in the manner that we've embraced it. And so to refuse to deal with this document would be a misunderstanding what Zambians are looking for. Yes, the answer is that Zambians want a new constitution. If they didn't want it, they would not have participated in the manner they did in the different processes. So there's no argument about that. I think that what is critical and what is important to the Zambian people is that if we don't get a new constitution, the current challenges that we are facing of excessive powers of the president are going to continue. We are going to see things that are retrogressive in terms of affecting our budgetary allocations, like by-elections, that are going to continue because some political party has more money to buy members of parliament from other political parties, and by-elections that are costing billions of kwacha in order to conduct, and all those anomalies in the current constitution, the effectivelessness of the vice presidency, you know, is also supposed to be addressed. The voting in of a president using the majority of voters or 50% plus one is something that we think is a necessity at the moment. And all these things speak to us that I think the document we have needs a review and it needs to be redone. And this job has been done by the Zambian people to the draft constitution level at great expense to the Zambian people. Now, yes, we need the new constitution and we need it now. Two, we have a problem now. The problem is that, and I can't get into all detail, the problem is now the PF got into government. One of the reasons people voted for them was because they promised that within 90 days they are going to provide and give and make available the constitution to the Zambian people. That has not happened. This is more than 90 days. This is 3 years down the road. Then, here's the irony of it. Then you hear Mr. Winter Kabimba, who is the Minister of Justice, make one of the most retrogressive and uninformed statements that any minister or any leader can ever make. And he says the Zambian people don't need a constitution. They need clinics, they need fresh water, they need hospitals, they need schools. Wait a minute, Kunda Kunda. You use the promise to give a constitution as a promise in order to get power. Once you get power, then you decide on the behalf of Zambians that although we told you we're going to do this because that's what you wanted, we have changed our minds, you don't need that, we think what you need is ABCD. In any case, here is the situation. Even if they wanted to change their direction, why then did the Patriotic Front, begin from the district level, district conferences for this constitution? Then they went to provincial conferences for this constitution. And then they had a national constitution with more than 600 people, which cost the Zambian taxpayer about 150 billion kwacha. Now, after you've gone through that process, then you say, no, the Zambian people want clinics and hospitals. Why didn't then, from the beginning, use the 150 billion to build those hospitals and all those clinics and those schools? Instead of them, after they have finished the process and spent 150 billion, then they say, no, the Zambians don't need it now. They need hospitals and clinics. It's an immoral stand. It's a stand that has cost the Patriotic Front so much political political clout. They have lost it because of that one particular lie, and they can't recover from it. The reason why they can't recover from it is because they have implicated themselves by playing a dilly-dallying game, trying to buy time. What is happening, it's not the Zambians running out of time. It's the PF running out of time. Because by the time we put the roadmap in place and we try to put a referendum in place, and the process could overshoot 2016. Now, they might think they have won the game by deceiving Zambians so that we go to the election on the old constitution. But it is them that have lost, because they have lied to the Zambian people, and they will enter that new election without fulfilling the most cardinal promise they made. And there will be no moral right or no moral reason for any Zambian to vote for the Patriotic Front, because they have not delivered the constitution within the record time that they gave to us. Now, if they can perform some magic right now to make sure that the constitution is given to us before 2016, maybe somehow they might redeem themselves. Although from my point of view, as leader of the movement for multi-party democracy, they are beyond redemption, because 90 days is over and they have said nothing in apology. But Mr. Kabimba, whom I personally believe is not that he's a bad man, he's just incapable of running the affairs of his office or being a minister of justice. In my view, and in the view of those of us from the MMD, we view him as a person who really doesn't have any clue what he needs to do. He sounds confused when it comes to the constitution. He does not understand what the aspirations of the Zambian people are. And his problem is not that he's a bad man. He's incapable of doing what we are expecting him to do. He does not have what it takes as a person to be able to carry out this major responsibility of constitution making. So our demand as MMD is that give us this day our constitution. You promised it. Be a little bit moral before you go out of office, at least by addressing the Zambian people and articulate your difficulties in order for the Zambian people to buy into reasons why you have not given us a constitution 3 years later.
Well, in case you're just joining us, this is Joy FM radio station meant for your ears only. I am Kunda Kunda on the platform program. Today we are discussing the MMD's wish list for power. And in the studios, I have with me Dr. Nevers Sekwila Mumba, who is MMD president. Let's take a look at the issue of relationship between you and other political parties. In case you are in power, how will your relationship with other political parties be? Especially that currently we have a lot of antagonism amongst political parties. If you are in power, you feel every other person who has a divergent voice is your enemy. How are you going to change that?
Firstly, I wanted to put something on record that on this program, I'm not going to discuss the state of the president, because I believe that that making a comment on insufficient information is a sign of poor leadership. We do not have sufficient information on the state of the president. The government has not yet provided it. Once they provide it, I'll be able to make a reasonable comment on the matter. But I think right now, I do not think it's an issue that I need to discuss, because we have insufficient information. Secondly, the issue of MMD and UPND issues that have been prevailing over the past few weeks, again, I'm not going to discuss that in this program, because it is not a priority to Zambians. I do not think it is something that I need to waste Zambian people's time on. I think that what is important is for us to harness the opposition, to harness our views, MMD to continue running as a political party, and the UPND to continue running, and the constant batting of one another. To me, I'm not going to be part of that, because that is not why Zambians have us existing as opposition parties. Having said that, I think that once in government, again, I have to fall back on the first line that I gave, that what we need now to move away from just changing governments to changing politics. I am committed to the fact that once we form government as the new MMD, our goal will be to ensure that every political party has got its liberty to participate in the development of our country, to the extent that a number of activities of those opposition parties that are really recognized in the country should be even funded from government coffers to be able to carry out some of their responsibilities, and not to be diminished, because opposition political parties help government see clearly, see better. And MMD, being a mother of democracy, one of our goals will be to ensure that we promote the organs of democracy, and opposition political parties are part of that democratic structure. And I think that just like the movement for multi-party democracy, just like the Patriotic Front in government wants to be funded, I think that opposition political parties need to be helped in being funded to carry out their responsibilities of civic education amongst their members, restructuring of their political parties, strengthening their levels of democracy within their political parties. Because I understand that, you know, some of the opposition political parties, the reason they don't have conventions is not just because they are not democratic. Some of them just don't have money to put up, you know, conventions. So they look very undemocratic. As you are aware, Kunda Kunda, at the moment, only probably the MMD today has a legitimately elected president in leadership. Almost every other political party, including the ruling party. Of course, they went to the convention where the president went unopposed. We have nothing to say about that, because being unopposed is also part of the process. But all of us know that for 10 years, the Patriotic Front did not have a convention, and the leaders were only appointed. Many other political parties on the scene today have not gone to conventions, and some of them, their mandates have expired, but they're still there. And sometimes it could be money, and sometimes it could be a lack of democracy. So I think that we need to assist opposition political parties once we come into government to have means to fight equitably the government in power on matters that concern Zambian people. To weaken the opposition, as the view has been over the past number of years, is a retrogressive program. It's a program that takes away from what Zambians are supposed to become. If you silence the opposition, drag them to courts and drag them to cells and drag them to prisons so that you instill fear in them and they stop talking, then you are the one to lose as a government in power, because no one is going to challenge you on the wrongs that you're doing. And what happens is what happened, unfortunately, in Libya, where a president feels very powerful because he has silenced all opposition. But when the guns are turned against that leader, That's when you realize how hated the leader was, how people would rise and drag that person in the streets, and people celebrating. Because when you're in power, you're moving limousines and the flag is flying, you think everybody loves you. No, no, no. People only love you when you feel for them, work with them and for them. It happened in Iraq. Saddam Hussein was a powerful person, powerful man, but he silenced opposition. And because he silenced opposition, he thought he was so loved and everybody liked him. The day that his life was taken, there was jubilation across the country. And I hope that us leaders who are aspiring for the position of president can be aware of these trends around the world. Because we usually say it can never happen to us. It happened in Egypt under Mubarak. Mubarak was one of the strongest presidents on the continent and respected in the United States, in the Western world, respected everywhere. But he had silenced opposition so much that the day he was removed from power, there was celebration in that country. And this is a lesson that leaders must learn, that people don't clap for you because they like you. They don't salute you. Those policemen saluting you, they are not saluting because they think you are so powerful and so good. They are saluting you because they need their salary at the end of the month. They have got children going to school. They have got needs to take care of. And so it remains your responsibility as a government or as a party in government to govern with your heart, to govern with morality and integrity, so that truly you are loved by your people, that they will defend you, they will protect you, and they will work with you. But right now, in most African countries, that's not the situation. So the new MMD back in government, under my leadership as president, we are going to make sure that we connect, we create a mechanism of cooperation with the electorate and the people, and they become the priority in our time of being in government, so that we are not vilified as dictators who try to silence the opposition. The opposition plays a role, and the opposition must be strengthened, and it shall be strengthened under our leadership.
Let's now take a look at the issue of the economy. And please, doctor, I know you're a doctor. You went to very good schools. I don't want sophisticated terms, GDPs, macro, micro. I think a friend or a brother on the streets is not going to understand, actually. Valanjipcha sometimes gandenda mu street bakamba fidaba doctor valanda fidati micro finishi fyakuria. So this time around, I just want us to concentrate more on how will the MMD make things affordable, ensure that we have at least an affordable cost of living. Meal prices are brought lower. People are able to afford cooking, and at least they can put three meals on the table. How will the MMD achieve that?
You know, you want me to be basic in the explanation of macroeconomics. I think that some of the things we can speak in our language. I mean, I'm not very good at certain other languages, and so it would be wrong for me to just speak in one language. I'm sure that since it's an English language, I mean, program, I'll stick with this. But the point that I want to bring up is that chiruwe chikalamba echo abanensuba PF bapangile kuisa mwakwambo kuteka wangu wafunyapo ama subsidies. Ama subsidies nishidenda matwale lunda po kutira obunga ngabushiti kwa 50 kwacha efo fwe buteko tuwabika po ba MMD 20 kwacha, so that aba leshito obunga bena bashita pali 30 kwacha ili atu ita subsidy tu ubuteko bule ya fwa bantu aba shikuwe tenda la motu na bena bale ili ya wino bale ikala wino aba nensu efe bachitili bafika fye mubuteko. The first two things they did was to remove subsidies from some of the most sensitive sectors of our economy. Bafunyama subsidies mukulia, kubunga, mu agriculture. Shida tuwale wikapo. Ifwe tuwale shicha fertilizer pali 50 kwacha. We nabaisa later pali 100 kwacha. That in itself is a big problem. Because now ubunga wali ya mboku ima, ukufuma pali 36 kwacha ida tuwabikile pa MMD. Ubunga nomba na ufika kuli 90 kwacha, munche nde shimbi, ngeko na afuma kuchinsali, ulefika na kuli 100 kwacha. That is number one. Wabula fuel, ama futa, ila tukomvya muli motoka, walunda kwa mutengo, wafunya kwa subsidy, which means fido uteko kwa layafwa, wafunya kwa mafuta, so that wadiyama le njama moto kano mabalashi chitwa fuel, pa mutengo ukalamba sana. But you must understand that the moment you remove subsidies from fuel, a subsidy from fuel, and increase fuel prices, everything goes up. Goods and services that are transported by vehicles and aeroplanes and ships and boats, everything goes up. Now, that happens in many economies. But the problem with our economy is that elo bafunisheko ishenda lama esho twale wika pofweba MMD utifyafu abapina. It means that nombo munga fiana ndile bwai mu mutengo. Pakufuma ku chilenje ukuisa mu town na mwavuma paka bwata ukuisa kulungu town na minibus. Nga malei pia 3 kwacha na malei pia 10 kwacha na 7 kwacha. Which means fionse fianina pantu wa minibus na bena mafuta balishita na yakoso mutengo tulo mfana wakunda am I complicated so far? Okay, so because of that the economy here was created, there is a high cost of living imi kali le mu Zambia na ikosa na issue pa kuli ordinary person because of yanama subsidies eyo bafunyapo fionse na fianina te fuel feka na malight na ina vice and income mutengo electricity. Now in all developed countries, when you want to increase energy cost, you can never increase it by more than 2% or 3%, because there's no economics that can handle such a blow of what they did here, of increasing it at 26%. 26%, although now it looks like it's almost 45% on energy cost in this regard, electricity. What does that mean? Everything powered by electricity gets expensive, whether any bread, it's baked using electricity. So what has happened now to our economy is that everything is expensive. The problem is didiali never fikosha fionse omutengo fyanin elo balanda mu parliament no mam kwaitu alaita freeze ama salaries takuli wakula tatwakulanu ndapwenda lama mwema unions tamakulaita negotiate for so many years, there will be no increment in salaries. What kind of an immoral move is that? In other words, the workers are still having MMD salaries, which we used to give them, but they're operating in a PF economy where everything has gone up. That's not the only problem economically. The kwacha that was, the MMD kwacha, which was at 4.3 kwacha to a dollar, was stronger and better than the PF kwacha, which is at 6.5 kwacha to a dollar. So, in other words, right there, even before the increase or freeze your salary, the kwacha, you have less money in your pockets just by virtue of the fact that our currency is connected to the international market, where the kwacha has to respond to the international forces of global economics. So, situation to kwete pano, indalama tuwa shile ba MMD, shali isha mano, isha akosa, uku chile indalama tu kwete isha ba PF, isha dipa 6.5 kuli $1. As though that is not enough, tashile tawale tupela ma increments. So people have not got enough money to buy the most expensive mealie meal, which they used to buy for cheap when they had more money in MMD. That is not how you run an economy. We vote for a government for specifically this reason, to make sure that the standard of living of its people is equitable. Somebody may not be a millionaire, but he must be able to buy a kabunga, nava kwe. Kaifele sal tupala mufiala, wandufiala 70, 10, fila fine. So we must be able to look after the basic needs. These basic needs are food, shelter. They must have water. We must have access to health care. And my child should be allowed to go to school. Now, this is not possible now. Ngamauva batimi kalile na ishupa. Abena Zambia fwalelanda fya kutila indalama twale kwata tatukwete. That is why MMD, someone will say MMD really means let's go back to more money days. MMD, let's go back to more money days, because during that time Zambians had money. They had money. That's when you saw for the first time an influx of vehicles in Lusaka, because MMD created a middle class. People who were not millionaires, but they were not poor. They could pay their bills. They could buy a car from Japan. They could move their children in vehicles. They could have a fridge in their homes. They could pay rents. But things have changed now. People are now starting to sell their cars, or if they are not selling them, amakazi na mboku call a number pamuse. Because MMD, they can't afford cars in this government. So I think MMD is committed to creating that kind of environment. Tukuti ngatuawela in government as the new party, as the new MMD, sorry, New Hope MMD. Our commitment is to ensure that we bring back, it's a one of macroeconomics kaina munkanya, we bring back ubukwebo bwachano. Ubo wule suminisha ukuti ama investors ayalele tendala mangefa na chitanda pa beginning ya program. Mm-hmm. When I was in Canada, I oversaw a huge investment opportunity when Lumwana Mine was bought for almost $8 billion. There was an excitement with investors coming to Zambia because, number one, the politics was right. They felt that the politics were predictable, that you won't wake up tomorrow morning and the president of MMD or the president of Zambia is going to say, from now on, I don't want Indians, or from now on, I think all the white people have to be paying so much. Like we have now, we have a government of ultimatums. They will go to a mine which is privately owned and start to make ultimatums. We want you to employ so many people. We want you to raise their salaries to these amounts. That kind of archaic leadership scares away investors. Investors are here to make a profit, and Zambia is here to benefit from that profit by having jobs created for them, for their people, and to ensure that there is taxes being paid to government as a result of the productivity of the private investment. So I think we're in a place now where that does not exist. MMD will come back to improve the quality or the environment of investment in our country like we did before. Secondly, we are going to ensure that government borrowing, domestic borrowing, is discouraged or reduced so that banks can have excess money to be able to give to small and medium scale business people, because MMD is a private sector driven party policy in economics. We believe that the private market is the one that determines the services and the cost of goods and services in the country. And we think that the encouragement, the growth, and the development of the private sector is going to become the engine for economic growth. So we would encourage that government lessens its domestic borrowing so that banks can have more money with reduced interest rates for our small businessmen to access capital. Because to grow an economy, Kunda Kunda, it's the small barber shop that you've opened in Kamwala. It's a small tea room place you have opened in Kawata, and then you have employed two people to be preparing two. You employ two here, you employ five there. The private sector, once it kicks in and supported by a responsible and responsive government, starts to develop the economy, starts to multiply jobs, starts to make sure that lives of people are improved. And we demonstrated this as MMD in government. And I think that it is something that we are going to do so that people can have disposable income, that they can continue to look after their families. And once I come to agriculture, I'll deal with that aspect as well.
Well, in case you're just joining us, this is the Platform Program on Joy FM Radio with me, Kunda Kunda. In the studios, I have with me Dr. Nevers Sekwila Mumba, who is MMD president, and we are discussing MMD's wish list for power. We take a brief break with a song from PK Chala, something called Common Man. We'll be back on the other side of this.
Yo bambi, danchi ya bapula mba. shinguruka umashitolo kwa jipari kyo baleshita bambi banwa ama ye umbaleli lana mapansi pamo mataba ishimbuna mutute baletu lirale.
Hello, I'm David Eads with BBC World News. Our top stories. Oscar Pistorius is back in the dock as the prosecution begins its closing arguments in his murder trial. Jailed for life, two surviving Khmer Rouge leaders will end their days in prison for their crimes against humanity. Talks continue on a durable truce in Gaza. Hamas denying there's any agreement yet on an extension of the three-day ceasefire.
Of course, whatever he was talking about then still applies even to date. How I wish we can have more of such music, music that outlives the musicians. But of course, just a reminder, we are discussing MMD's wish list for power, and in the studios I have with me Dr. Nevers Sekwila Mumba, who is MMD president. Before we had the breather, we were looking at issues to do with the economy. Now let's quickly look at issues to do with the agriculture sector. How do you hope to strengthen this sector so that it lessens the country's overdependency on copper, which is a wasting asset?
Thank you, Kunda. You remember that during the days of Kenneth Kaunda and UNEP, Dr. Kaunda realized early in his leadership, especially during that season when we had a slump in copper prices, he realized that copper was a wasting asset. And there was an introduction of what he was calling go back to the land, you know, reviving agriculture, and starting projects all across this country that were agricultural based. I think the idea was correct. The president understood at that point that our wealth really lay in agriculture, good agriculture policies that were going to result in good agricultural output. Now, unfortunately, after a while, we fell back on copper again to become the sole foreign exchange earner for the country. And each time we have done that, we have paid a very high price in terms of the returns for the country, because we become a mono economic house. And I think if anything happens to the copper prices, the whole country stumbles down. And once the copper prices go up, we start to live lives again. And I think that we need to avoid that. So agriculture to us, as the Movement for Multi-Party Democracy, has demonstrated during the time that we're in government, we ensure that we put the very best brains in that department. And one of the difficulties that we are having as MMD, watching the PF government, is that there is no pressure for them to find the most skilled people to play specific roles. I think for us, we think that each field has got people, like we say, Mchibembaba ile kunsakwe, mkwe abelenga, pali ile ine topic ya agriculture. Those are the people we should give the responsibility to guide us in those areas. But this issue of just using anybody to say, either you are related to me, or my uncle came to see me that his nephew has no job, so we'll make him the Minister of Agriculture. This is what has killed many African countries, including our country. This thing is not about giving my son a job. This thing is about giving Zambia a successful agricultural sector, out of which even your son is going to benefit if you could do it the right way. So I think that the policy that we put in agriculture's MMD was more to empower the ordinary farmer, the subsistence farmers, to become the biggest contributors to the national basket, as opposed to just working with the commercial farmers. So that is when we introduced the fertilizer support system program, which I was involved in very directly when I was vice president, to ensure that, you know, we assisted the poorest of the poor to be given a package of seed and fertilizer for them to participate in the agricultural sector, and also give them extension support programs to help them maximize their yield, and also to guide them on how they could prepare their yield for sale. And we made available the FRA to be timely in purchasing the maize so produced, so that our farmers do not have to commit their maize to FRA and then have to wait for 9 months or 10 months to be paid, which I think is totally immoral. So we made sure that all those bottlenecks were clearly worked on, and insisted that when deciding on the floor price of maize, we did not do it like the white people are doing, we're doing in the West when we're colonized. Even now, that we produce the copper here in Zambia. It's from our land, as God has given it to us. Then London has to determine the price of a commodity we produce here. I think that's immoral. We are the ones who sweat to dig it out of the ground. We are the ones who work hard, and our people die in Mfulira mines. They're killed in order to extract that metal. Then somebody in London or Switzerland decides how much we're going to sell it to them. I think that is totally immoral. But that's a system of the world that has colonized, continued to economically colonize Africa, out of which we need to remove those shackles. I think that I'm looking forward to a time when we could determine our own worth of what we produce. That is number one. But I'm seeing it in agriculture, that the elitist government offices in their boardrooms, without any reference to the growers of maize and farmers, decide the floor price to be 65 kwacha or 70 kwacha as the floor price at this particular point, not really considering what has happened. Listen to this very basic analysis. When we were in government, Kunda Kunda, they bought fertilizer from us, the farmers, at 50 kwacha. 50 kwacha per bag. Mm-hmm. And the floor price we set was 65 kwacha. So even without doing much arithmetic and being simplistic, I can say that if you are fertilizer for 50 kwacha, remove the labor that you used, and then you're going to find that you sell your maize at 65 kwacha. At least you make a hypothetical 15 kwacha profit. 50 kwacha fertilizer and the bag is 65 kwacha. Today we have a situation which doesn't even make any economic sense. The fertilizer is 100 kwacha now. The floor price is somewhere around 70, I think. So really, even through straight arithmetic, they are growing maize at a loss of 30 kwacha. And I think that the Zambian people are feeling it now, that why should some people in a boardroom in Lusaka decide the floor price when we are the ones producing the maize? They are the ones who are being bitten by the snakes in their farms. They are the ones that are sweating it from 6 o'clock in the morning to 6 o'clock in the evening, trying to produce that commodity just for some minister and his permanent secretary to sit in a boardroom and decide that it's going to be 65. We have to come to a place of serious consultation with the producers of the product in determining what they get for what they produce. And I think MMD was committed to that program. And once back in government, we are going to do that. That is why, for 3 years in a row, MMD produced record bumper harvest. Now, the bumper harvest they talked about by the minister now is a hypothetical, clinical, laboratory projection of a bumper harvest, based on absolutely no figures, based on no proper agricultural policy, and they are just hoping that they are going to have a bumper harvest, and having invested very little in the sector of agriculture. So I think going back into agriculture, we think that that is the mainstay of every Zambian, because if we can produce enough and feed ourselves, then we are going to come to a place where we should not even restrict our farmers. If they are closer to Congo and they can sell their maize for 200 kwacha instead of the 65 kwacha floor price made here, I think in a liberalized world, people should be able to choose their markets. They should be able to sell to the highest market that is there for them, because they're the ones who are laboring for us. So the government must cooperate with the growers of food so that these people have liberty to sell their food to somebody who's going to give them the best money. And I think that it is important for MMD to come back into government to implement these things, because we are a private sector driven team that believes and respects private sector as the engine for economic development in our country. So agriculture will continue to be our concern, and we will make sure that our fertilizer and inputs are taken there on time in order for our farmers to have their yield timeously and be able to carry out their lives with their families.
Time is not our best ally, but if we can maybe discuss as quickly as possible the other issues, it will really be wonderful. This is a year of jubilee, a year when we are commemorating 50 years. And if it's a man, if a man reaches 50, definitely you see a lot of differences. At least you see a significant change in a man. As we are commemorating our 50 years of existence, of independence as a nation, what do you think should be the role of past leaders in national development, and also your comments on how we should be united as a nation, in national unity?
50 years as a nation is a big number, and I encourage every Zambian to reflect on where we've come from and where we wish to go. I think Zambia has faltered over the years in the honoring and respect of those that have labored very hard for our country, whether it's in sport, broadcasting, we have produced some of the greatest. We have produced the Kalusha Warriors, the Musondas, the Yukas of this world, but very little acknowledgement is made to about them. Then in the broadcasting world, we have produced the Dennis Liwewes that the whole world marveled, and yet we ourselves don't see it. I mean, we've got in every sector of our country, we are a blessed nation, and we have had presidents that have come and moved us from one level to the next level. And unfortunately, we have spent time vilifying and prosecuting and persecuting these former leaders. And I think that the New Hope MMD wants to bring that to a stop once and for all. I want to be honest that one of the reasons why a lot of former presidents, for instance, on the continent of Africa, usually wish to come back to power, it's because they feel that they are not recognized or respected or given the honor that is due to them. I mean, if somebody was in State House and used to being a leader, and then when he leaves that place, all you do is to disrespect him, try to find fault against him, try to imprison him for something that probably one officer in the Ministry of Education did, and he was not even aware of it because of the size of government. And that kind of persecution has really cost Zambia the image that it should portray to the rest of the world. And so our commitment, and my commitment as president, when God allows us to govern, I think my commitment would be that all former leaders must be so respected that they help us in cleaning up, enhancing, and improving the image of Zambia internationally, representing us in critical places, so that Zambia can continue to benefit from these former presidents. MMD, for instance, is privileged to have a former president still alive in the name of President Rupia Banda, one of the most distinguished diplomats in the world, in our country. I think that he has the longest diplomatic service record in this country. And so a person like that, once we form government, he's a man that I believe every Zambian should look to represent us in many places, because he understands the world of diplomacy. He understands a lot of things in that regard. And so I think that for me, a lot of presidents, former presidents, have not been given the respect that is supposed to be given to them. They have not been given the honor that is supposed to be given to them. And I think that this whole issue of prosecuting former presidents on flimsy grounds and things that they are not even proven, and waste their time until they die, they are just frequenting their homes to court until time comes for them to die. I think it's unfortunate, and we are going to make an about turn. You will not see that under my leadership. Under my leadership, you are going to see former presidents playing a role like the American former presidents play. When a former president comes to Zambia from the United States, they're received just like presidents. They are respected because they have already held that position. It's like a general. Once a general, always a general. Once a president, always a president. In fact, in the United States, they don't call them former presidents. In the United States, they actually address them as presidents because they don't want to lose that clout that they have. There's no insecurity in the new president to feel that if the former president is given a visible role, he's going to overshadow me. There's nothing like that. You are in power. You are governing the country. They are helping you to make your country look better. Don't be threatened by former leaders. Those are there for you to support you, to make you look better, to make you look stronger. So our goal is to ensure that all the former presidents are helped so that this desire by former presidents to get back into politics will no longer be necessary and no longer be there because they have the respect and they have what they need.
Could caused by some sections of your party for Mr. Rupia Bwezanbanda to come back and take the mantle of leadership of the MMD be an indication of the lack of confidence that they have in you?
I don't think so. I think that, like I've already said, the issue of former presidents coming back or being called to come back into power is an international phenomenon. It's a continental phenomenon, especially for Africa. You remember, after President Kaunda left power, people started to call for President Kaunda to come back. We want Kenneth Kaunda to come back, because they were used to Dr. Kaunda. He was in power for 27 years. Some people knew nothing else, felt totally insecure under a new president. I mean, people are not used to change, so they want to fall back on the old, thinking that they can restart the old formula again. But times have changed, as you noticed for UNIP. It was an erroneous decision. It cost UNIP everything, because it's like saying Kalusha, well, they want him back. He has to play again because we used to score a lot and we need... No, Kalusha now needs to be a coach. Kalusha now needs to coach the others, the younger people, because Kalusha will not live forever. So he cannot just be the one scoring. He has to now produce others. That's why I'm so happy Kalusha is still in football. He's now the president of FAS, and he continues to share his expertise with the younger people so that Zambia could continue winning games. So MMD, anybody can call for... The people still would have called for President Chiluba if he was still alive. It's just a question of where your allegiance has been and where your comfort zone is. But I would not want to involve President Rupia Banda or drag him into politics, because he has said it so many times, including today's newspaper today, where he said, please keep me out of politics. I've played my part and don't drag me into this. And I don't want us to drag him. President Rupia Banda and I enjoy a wonderful relationship. That's why you see me every time, whenever he's being vilified and being taken to court, I'm there with him, shoulder to shoulder with him. I believe in him. I believe that he played his part. He did an excellent job in terms of growing the economy and also starting one of the most ambitious infrastructural development in this country. And I think we need to honor him for that. But to drag him into politics, I think that we are not being fair and maybe even malicious. But I think the president himself has spoken for himself today when he said, please don't drag me into the political process. And I think that we will continue to honor him and give him the respectable place in the movement for multi-party democracy. That is why I enjoy my moments with him and make sure that we exchange notes from time to time.
Well, we are discussing the MMD's wish list for power. The numbers you are going to be getting us on are 0954-570-685 or 222-640, and we already have a caller online. Hello, good morning.
Yes, good morning. How are you?
Wonderful.
Yeah, thank you very much. And I greet everyone who's listening to me. This is the Lukuru voice. And good morning, Dr. Mumba.
Good morning, sir.
Thank you very much. Good morning to Professor Chichin, coming president.
Thank
coming
you.
To the issue, you have discussed a lot of issues there. Really, in this country, we are in problems. You know, the people of Zambia made their choice in 2011. They removed MMD after appreciating it 20 years of rule. They brought in the PF. According to their promises, to better the lives of Zambian people, to give the Zambian people the constitution within 90 days. To my surprise, things have changed specifically. Now, you are now coming there again as MMD to say you want to come back to power. But remember that there were two opposition political parties. There is UPND and PF, and then PF scoped. And then what remained, it was UPND. So people of Zambia, they would like to trust also UPND to see what they can do rather than bring back the MMD. I think that one, I think it won't solve any problem. You have to continue remain in opposition, give checks and balances. We need you. You have the history to make. But to hundwick people in believing in you, now that you're even abusing this one, Lusambo, to be issuing statements, I think, to other opposition political party like Professor Church, I think that's wrong, and you have remained quiet. It's very wrong. Can we support each other as opposition? Together, we're going to drop. There's a time for MMD, there's time for UNIP, MMD, this is time for PF. We have to kick it out. The time for UPND comes. And so we just have support. If someone has a good idea, support. Who are you to say no? The Zambian people, they know that next government here is UPND. So please, you, MMD, you are there for the record. We appreciate the work you do. So we have to change. Democracy is to change. This power, this party comes, that other party goes, just like that. That's how we believe in democracy. We don't behave like dictators, no. Otherwise, the Nevers Mumba continue with MMD as opposition, give checks and balances. Even UPND, when it comes to power, you give checks and balances. Ask it to be a different governance system. People enjoy benefit of changing the government, not just changing them, as we see now. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much for coming through. We have another caller on online here. Hello. Good morning.
Good morning, Kunda Kunda. How are you today?
Very well, thank you.
Sure. Good morning, President Nevers Mumba.
Good morning, good morning. Brother who?
Brother Chisha.
Okay.
Brother
Chisha. Yes, please. I
am
going to ask you. Brother Chisha, now, I'll ask you to quickly make your point so that I allow as many people as possible to come through.
Let me just conclude on this one, my friend.
Mm-hmm.
My question to the government is that, can you at least one or two things where you see that PF is performing well? Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for coming through. Of course, even for text messages, you can come through on 0965-420-875. You can also text your questions or contributions to 0965 42-20-875. I think, yeah. Dr. Mumba, you can respond.
Yeah, thank you. Let me start with the last question because I remember that one. Wachisha, mkwaibungu mfwe wino sana, wino sana. Telugu yuluyo ni democracy na ma politics. Mwifuruwa na kariyayo. Busheba PF, bali chitapwe fintu ifisume fwe tuinga batotela. I'm sure bali chitapwe fintu ifisuma. And ZNBC, Daily Mail, Times of Zambia, The Post, ilalanda pone, ileko nkanya pokula ndefyo. Ine, nangu ifweba MMD, who are in the opposition to provide checks and balances. There is no standard that we can use to judge the Patriotic Front except their own standard, which they raised as the platform upon which they wanted to get elected. Some of the projects that are going on are projects that were not even in their promises. They were projects that were left by the Movement for Multi-Party Democracy. Mula Kupikwa, you know, college in Chinsali, those projects and things that are being done, the road networks that are being built, they were left in the process, including the Pedico Road. When I was vice president, we started to work on that and finding contractors and also finding funding. We did the Lebi Mwanawasa Bridge, but the new government came and took over those things and continued to operate. That's the way government should do. But we are only judging Patriotic Front on their promises, their 90-day promises. And even when we Kunda, mufilemu asumina na abantu aba mu Zambia, ukutila kwena apa ba Patriotic Front, uchiruwa wapanga, nifu ya bala ndi at 90 days baka chitefu, pata waibwe la kubantu, no kulonda ati mwe bantu mutu eleleko, tatuwa ishiwe utinchito yali fula, kari yali kakata. Tulefa tuwombele pamu, ukutila nomba, tuchitefi nefi nefi. But fionze fi balanda, inchito isho mulanda teko shaba, shaba lela na nava sanga iso 365, that is not true. The way we used to do it in MMD is that once we provide employment, we'd go sector by sector and release a document that explains those jobs. They are pensionable jobs. They are jobs that somebody can look at as respectable jobs. These are not the jobs that are being made now. How can they be done when there's no investment in the country that is being done on a regular basis? That is number one. So in a Nabanandi wants more MMD, we are looking at their promise of what they promised to do. Have they done it? The answer is no. Two, when you go kuli issue, you have a national secretary that he already talked about the UPND. Why should I stop talking about it? First, you have already said it, that he has already talked about it. So if he has already talked about it, it's already done. I cannot keep going on there because that's not the reason I was voted for as MMD president. I was not voted for to discuss another opposition political party. Secondly, I think that you are right that if they had to ask me, you know, because they wanted to respond and do ABCD, there are certain things I said no to, that it was not necessary. But they convinced me that, look, from the time I joined politics as Nevers Mumba, you know, which is almost 18 years ago, as a pastor, when, for instance, the current president used to criticize me, including statements of saying Nevers has abandoned the church, when I'm still the president of the church, the Victory Ministries, and still have 52 churches, and I preach every Sunday. Up until this Sunday, I've been preaching. We preach all over the place. But he kept saying something which was not true. And some Zambians, up to today, believe that Nevers has left the church. Up to today. Because I didn't rebut that. They would say that Nevers has done this, I didn't rebut it. They said Nevers is like this, I didn't rebut it, because I didn't think it was necessary. But if you don't answer back, people take it as the truth. So my team convinced me that there were serious things that Mr. Kabimba raised that have become stereotype songs of our opponents. And we need to answer them. Time to answer those things has come. And they decided to answer. My colleague raised certain issues, Honorable President H.H., which I felt that, you know, they needed to be, answers needed to be provided. And they did provide those answers. Hopefully, our members understand that what was being raised was erroneously raised, and it was not the truth. And that was the whole thing. It was covered, and there's no need for me to go back into those matters. I think that the Zambians are not expecting us to continue with that. They want us to talk about how we are going to make their lives better. Then there's a friend of mine who asked who gave his opinion that MMD has played its part, PF now is playing its part, the next one is UPND. I wish life was like that. I wish life was a straight line where you say after UPND then it will be NAREP, then after NAREP it will be ADD, after ADD then it will be, that would be a wonderful lineup of opportunity. But history tells us that usually power goes back and forth between two political parties, unless there's a real big break of something. When you go to different countries like the United States, today it's the Democrats in power. And by the way, there are more parties in America than two. There's a Green Party, there are many other political parties. But after the Democratic Party loses power, the Republicans take it. And then the Democrats go back into reorganizing themselves, looking at the mistakes they made, cleanse themselves from those sins, because once you have been knocked down, when you get up, you'll be a better boxer than you were before you were knocked down. You'll be more careful, you throw more straight punches than you were throwing wild punches. So actually MMD can only become better in governance with experience and watching the mistakes we did ourselves, and also watching the mistakes PF is doing, making, and then once we get back into government, it will be a better government, because we would have learned our lesson, we have been slapped upside the head, and now taught a lesson. But those issues should be debated on radio, and Lukulu is welcome, because you know it's good for him also to think that that's the order in which Zambians are going to vote.
Okay. Yeah. I have a set of text messages here. This one is not very kind. He says, Nevers means never become a president. It's good to have jokers and noisemakers. My number is 0977-454-803. Put it in your diary and be reminded after 2016 when PF is crowned with power for continuity. Your mathematics is wrong, Nevers. One bag of fertilizer can't produce one bag of maize, even in hell. MMD wasted a lot of this country, made people lazy, non-productive people who really depended on free stolen monies. We have been in other countries which are doing better and see how money is being cherished. Zambia is on a better track for paradise tomorrow, SATA 2016. This is Masonga Daka from Town Center. Then I have this other one. It says, Hi President Mumba, I agree with you that in agriculture you did better than PF. PF has failed the people of Zambia, from Sinamanda in Lusaka. This other one says, Good morning from Elder Musanje. I want Pastor Mumba to come back to the preaching of God's word, for politics and preaching cannot move together. This time he has used here was to be used for preaching. This other one says, Hello President Mumba, do you really think Zambians will vote MMD back into power after recently voting it out? Be very honest. This one is Mwene. Your quick comments and brief ones so that we allow as many people as possible to come through.
Very, very quickly. I think that the last one of saying would people vote MMD back, I think people now can compare the old, you know, the MMD and the PF. Secondly, MMD has a new leader. I was not the president in the last term MMD was in power. I'm a Zambian with a vision that God gave me when I was very young, and I've grown with it. I've proved myself both in raising one of the strongest church ministries in the world, and it's still strong. We've got pastors all over the world that are preaching, that graduated from my Bible college here in Zambia. We have gone ahead and served, like I said, in another country as an ambassador, served as vice president. So I think that we are ready to provide leadership, and I think that Zambians will judge the new president of MMD within his own right, and not for him to carry the cross or the sins of President Satan, President Vice President Guy Scott when they were in MMD. And I think that we are doing our very best to rebrand and to renew the MMD. So I believe that MMD will come back, because it's got a new leadership, it's got a new team, and it's rebranding itself. Thank you so much for the other gentleman that sees what I'm saying concerning agriculture. I think it's important. that people are honest, that where things went right, we should be ready to say it went right. For the first person who said never means never, I send it back to the sender. In Jesus' name, let him get that message himself. He cannot use that thing on me. But the important thing to say about what he has said is that we are going to call the number he gave us, and I hope it is going to be God who is going to answer on the other side. Because if it's not God, then he is not the final authority who decides who becomes president tomorrow and whether PF continues or does not continue. He is not God. God has the last say. So we'll try to call that number. If God answers, then we know what he has said is what's going to happen.
Wow, wonderful. You're still listening to the platform program. Wow. I have to cut this line. Please, when you come through the radio station, make sure you reduce the volume on your radio set. Hello, good morning.
Hello, good morning.
Yes, kindly speak up. You're very low. We lost that one. 222640 is the number you're getting us on, or you can send us a text message to 0965-420-875, or you can call 0954-570-685. Hello, good morning.
Hello, good morning, sir.
Yes, good morning.
Thank you very much. This is Spoiler. Dr. Mumba, good morning.
Good morning, sir.
Thank you very much. I don't want to to waste much of your time, but I have got two critical questions.
Yes, sir.
First of all, the question that I want to ask you, you were quoted in the media at a certain ceremony where you raised a divisive statement, and where I did not expect that statement come from the man who is a pastor, the man who should spearhead a reconciliatory way, who should be using a unifying language. And I want to know if it's true that that language that was you used to the HH, associating him heading a regional party, if that is true, shall we know from this media? Then another thing, I think you have told us that you are still connected to your church. I don't know if this connectedness that you are still heading, because the risk is that you may use the church proceeds for political propensity, for political expedience. That's why most pastors are not supposed to be given that privilege, that you are heading a church here, again you are heading a political, because the likelihood are high that you may abuse the money that's supposed to gospel the word of God. How do you find it easy that on the other hand you are heading the church, on the other hand you are heading a political institution? This is my concern. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much for... Thank you so much for coming through. Doc, before you respond, let me just quickly go through text messages. This one says, Pastor Mumba, how's your personal relationship with President Sata Geshom from Mandevo? The other one says, UPND can't win an election because they're a tribal party. Well spoken, Dr. Mumba. We need a new constitution and we need it now. From John Banda Lusaka. This other one says, morning Kunda and the President. Dr. Mumba, you are the only redeemer for this calamity we are going through from the hands of this bunch of crooks. Viva Dr. Mumba, viva MMD, he says Muzaza Soko and things like that. The other one says Nevers is next Peter. I don't understand what this is all about, but of course, Doc, you can quickly
understand the next Peter either, but... let me begin with the first question that I raised a divisive statement. There was a whole full press briefing by my national secretary to address that particular question, and he did an excellent job in explaining that. And I'm glad that the caller.
Yes, maybe as you're also responding to that, is also another one says, Mr. Mumba, don't raise your hopes higher. You sold your church and party for the love of money. You're likely to sell the people of Zambia for a few pieces of silver. MMD is a closed chapter. Viva PF is Musonda. So maybe you can also...
Thank you so much. I'm very glad that the first caller actually doubted whether those words about me calling UPND a regional party came from my mouth. And he rightly put it that you're a man of God and you're supposed to be bringing words of healing. I am grateful for his consideration, that he understands that there are certain things that when people hear, they'll say, yes, it came from Nevers Mumba. But there are certain things that when they hear, they'll say, absolutely not, that's not Nevers. And one, that statement is one of those. When people read that I said that UPND was a regional party, they have never heard me say that. They have never heard me go that low in politics. I believe in intelligent politics. If I'm going to compete against President Sata and I'm going to compete against HH, we are going to have an intellectual fight on policy positions. That's why I'm calling that we should have debates on these all policy matters, whether it's economics, whether it's a style of governance that we are going to bring about. We cannot just be shouting or tell our cadres to just say, we are the next government. You don't do that based on what? You've got to have a reason that you want to be president. You have to have a reason why you want to govern. And you have to convince and persuade people in that regard. So that is why I'm looking for I'm hungry for some intelligent debate, intelligent engagement on governance. And so I didn't say those words. The post has my recording, and our team has already gone to the post to find out why they did what they did. I never said UPND was a regional party. Never. Nowhere. And the recording is there, and anyone interested can go and rescue that recording. And I've listened to it myself, because we demanded for it. There's no statement like that. It was fabricated by the Post newspaper. And it's unfortunate that my colleague answered to that. But I do understand that it sounded very strange coming from a person like myself. Then you say that he says that you can use church money to support politics. Well, firstly, the first thing I want to say is that yes, I am leader of the ministry, but I don't draw any salary, and I have not drawn any salary from the church for the past 15 years. So I provide leadership. I meet all my leaders from all provinces once a year and give them guidance on how they should proceed. And each church has got its own pastor. And so I don't have to be there to pastor them, but I provide the moral leadership to the church. Just like President Levi Mwanawasa was a lawyer. His law firm continued to operate. He was not there. At that time, his wife was doing it and then handed it over to some other people who did that. There are many people, when they become presidents, their concerns are mitigated by those that they have raised and prepared. So our ministry has got many, many pastors, and they have continued to run the ministry. There's no possibility of me using that money for political means, just to answer him. What is my relationship with President Sata? I think my relationship is cordial. I think my relationship is good with the president. From the beginning, I had made my position very clear that I will never speak against President Sata in an insulting manner or in a manner where I sound like I am disrespecting him, for two reasons. Firstly, he comes from the same area I come from. Our elders. There's nothing I can say against him that should make him look small. Secondly, if there's going to be any difference or has been any difference between me and the president, it's basically and purely on policy matters and positions or how a policy position has been executed. But the president knows that I respect him deeply. He knows that I pray for him and he knows I'm there for him. But once it comes to the issues of policy, we have usually held different views on that matter. So I think for now those are some of the questions.
Yes,
that,
definitely. We have a call online. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, kindly reduce the volume on your radio set.
Hello.
Yes. Good morning.
Good morning, sir. How are you?
Very well, thank you. Who are we talking to?
You are talking to Minyakarabo.
Okay.
Yes. Good morning, President Mumba.
Good morning, sir. How are you?
It's nice to hear you on the radio once more, President Mumba.
Thank you very much.
Yes. You are saying you can't talk again about what Lungu said on the media condemning UPND. Me, I believe as your opposition parties, you are supposed to work together. You should not be washing linen in the public. for how long you have been working together with the UPND. But this time, the way your Secretary General was talking on the media, I think that was very, very unfair. Where he even said, UPND can't win the election. You remember when Sata was campaigning? Do you remember what MND was saying? They were saying Sata will never rule. You remember? Which was totally wrong. Lungu is not God. But according to what I have seen myself personally, and I believe this is a gift God gave me. Trying to prophesy what comes. Tell you, President Mumba, UPND is taking it. Believe me or not, but this is the truth I'm telling you. Me, I've already seen this vision. That the next president of this country is President Egypt. Whether people are going to talk what, the truth will show. You will remember my words. Mark it. So there is no need of trying fighting each other as the opposition. Let's work together because we are fighting one person. Who are we fighting? We are fighting PF. So as opposition party.
I ask you to quickly make your point together, so that we allow other people to come through.
Yes, we should work together to make sure that we remove the bad men who are in PF. Whereby the president, even not they are hiding, even the president. So my advice to you, President Mumba, is that tell your men that they should not be insulting or talking evil things against UPND in the public. Even if they've got a problem, you can call them. You have a meeting, you discuss as a family. I think that's my take.
Okay, thank you so much for coming through. Doc, before we take another caller here, I have a list of messages. This one says, "Hi Doc, I agree with you that you can bounce back, but not now. Mind you, PF has done a lot, and come 2016, PF is winning with or without Washkulu." This is Zulu from Millennium Town Center. This other one says, "PF is a finished party in government." The other one says that never mind about HH. And who is HH, by the way? This one hasn't indicated his name. The other one says, "President Mumba, Kainde Ichilem and UPND is the man at the moment. Sorry to say that you are far below par to HH. HH's articulation of national issues is more understandable than yours, and chances are that soon you either join UPND or maybe even the disastrous Patriotic Front." This one just says cow. The other one says, "MMD better than the regional party UPND. Viva MMD." This other one says, "Good morning, Pastor Mumba. Ignore UPND supporters who call on every radio station on every program. Elections are not won on radio. Viva MMD." This one is Amos from Lusaka. The other one says, "Hello, Mr. Mumba. Go, never give up. 2016 is MMD." The other one says, "Dr. Nevers, don't be discouraged. MMD performed better in agriculture and economics, $4.7 and things like that." And of course, this other one says, "Dr. Mumba, you're a great leader. Don't listen to noisemakers." The other one says, "Nevers ulichaume sana. Don't fear anyone because it's not your nature." So maybe I allow maybe just calls to come through. Hello, good morning.
Hello, good morning. This is Matthew. Good morning.
Yes, Matthew, good morning.
Yes, I'm okay. Mm-hmm. Yes, I want to express my opinion.
Yes.
I find the one problem with Zambian opposition parties, the aim that opposition have is just to remove PF, but not to tell the people, to convince the people what they're going to do if they could be in power. So you need to advise them to consider to do the right things or to do the right things, what is going to give to offer to the people of Zambia, not just to lash to the government just to remove PF. That is not fair. Convince people what you're going to do to the people of Zambia, not just to aim to go in government to have nothing to offer to the people of Zambia. That is not fair. That is my point of opinion.
Okay. Thanks so much for coming through. 22640 is the number you are getting us on. When you come through, please tell us your names and where you're calling us from and be as brief as possible. Hello, good morning.
Hello.
Yes, good morning. Yes, who are we talking
morning,
to?
Kunda Kunda. Morning, Mr. Doctor.
Good morning. Good morning. Yes.
Morning, Doc. Eddie within Osaka.
Yes, sir.
I think it's important to respect the fellow human being. Dr. Mumba also is better to be very honest in life. Are we together, Doctor?
I'm listening, Ed.
You're sending this boy called the Lusambo, insulting HH every day on either the Phoenix, Radio Phoenix, and the Radio Hot FM. I don't know what is behind this boy called Lusambo. And you have also made sure Lusambo kills this fellow leader in the MMD, the last two president. You use the Lusambo to chase Madame Nawa, this woman from Betauke, Dora Siria. Lusambo has a dead language. He needs prayers, perhaps, from you being a pastor. And please stop using that boy, because he looks like that even a Zambian chap, like man. So please, we need to respect in pointing. Don't worry, you are doing things behind you, Mr. Your Secretary General, and also Lusambo, Bowman Lusambo. So, as Mumba, what we are telling you today that we are all Zambian. Even the patriotic friend who thinks they own this country, let them also respect the wishes of others. What we are seeing today that President Sata has gone underground, and no one in this country will vote for President Sata, who is hiding. So it's important for you politicians to come out and tell the Zambian people that we need the leader. And you are today now protecting.
I'll ask you to quickly make your point so that we allow other people to come through.
Kunda Kunda, you have given a lot of time to have these CPF cadres. Let me talk. What we are saying today, Kunda Kunda, I don't know what we are scared of. Let us demand for the whereabouts of our president. It's not president for PF, it's a president for the nation. So even you journalists, you have let this country down. Because you are not accurately reporting what is happening on the ground. Let you have a country right, which has not. And you are there smiling.
Thank you so much for coming through. But doctor, please, instead of embedding the family messages, yeah, but definitely I will give you enough time so that I think maybe this will be the close. This one says UPND is cheating themselves. We Zambians don't want any experiment anymore. Go MMD. This is Mr. John Banda. This other one says, Nevers, please, if all developmental projects being done by the PAF now, as you claim, were initiated by MMD, why didn't MMD explain those projects when you were still in power? Be honest. Nipabwa atofie na Mpundu Lusaka. This other one says, Dr. Mumba, you're the chosen one. In the days of old, the Bible says the world was ruled by those who feared and loved him. This is Chomba. Viva MMD. This other one says, Mr. Mumba, MMD is the water under the bridge. If you think that you shall bounce back, not in Zambian politics, Yona Longe. The other one says, Dr. Nevers Mumba, to say the least, you've really had it tough. You've been beaten left, right, and center. Just soldier on. Otherwise, without certain forces, MMD would be too strong. This is from TK. The last one says, I guess Lusambo is a hero. UPND is in pain of him. More fire, Lusambo. Okay, I think there are a lot of people who are talking about Bowman, and I think you should really address this matter. The last one, let me also read this one. It says, Doc, are you anti-disabled? Can you clear the air? Some of us are beginning to believe. Mike T. Center, I don't understand what he means. The problem is HH, not Lusambo. The other one says, Mr. Mumba, you are not capable to become a president, and whether you like it or not, PF will rule for 50 years. Viva Sata, viva PF. This is from Matilda Mutale. Doctor, I think you have so many questions to respond to. I'll give you enough time.
Thank you so much. I think that it's very, very interesting sitting from here listening to Zambians put in their views. The good news is that all human beings are exactly that, just human beings. We have interests, we support particular candidates and support particular interests. And this is the beauty of democracy, which MMD brought, that we can have a program like this, where somebody says, no, meet my president, who will be the president, and you are finished, only my party. But, you know, as a pastor, you know, it's very interesting for me that you can tell people speaking out of fear, you know, when they speak with a lot of passion, but you can feel it's fear, that probably what they're projecting, they are not even confident themselves. Let me start with the issue of Lusambo. Mr. Lusambo has been in MMD for a long time. When I won the presidency, I found him there. In fact, he was leading a group called Die Hard for RB when I came in. And he leads an organization that is auxiliary and not within the structures of the MMD, like many other political parties in the world, including South Africa. ANC has got auxiliary bodies that
is he support. The Julius Malema of Zambia?
I don't think so. He's the Lusambo of Zambia, I think. But I think that one thing I need to make very clear is that I have never, even if maybe silently or through using people you know, given any words to Lusambo. The Zambian people know a statement that is coming from Nevers Mumba, and a statement that is not coming from Nevers Mumba, number one. Number two, Nevers Mumba will never be afraid to state a position. If I have something against HH as my brother, I'll tell him to the face, either in our private meetings, which are many, or in my telephone conversations with him, which are many, in our exchange of texts, which are many. HH and myself talk to each other. So if I have a concern about him, I'm not going to use Lusambo. I'm not that weak, I'm not that cheap to be using somebody else to express my views. I would never do that. I've never done it. Whether it's from my pulpit when I'm preaching, I never do shadow boxing. I hit the target, I say what needs to be said, and I pay the price for it. I've never shunned away from saying the truth and what I believe. So Lusambo, I've never given him a statement, and that might shock a lot of people, not one statement. Sometimes I would call him when I read a statement to ask him what that statement was all about and with whom did he clear that statement. And sometimes I'm just as shocked as everybody else. And we have continued to make sure that he abides by those regulations that have been put there by the party. And I think that any time he goes away from the party position, when he mentions the party, the national secretary and the secretariat have all the instruments in their hands to deal with him. So I just want to make sure that everybody understands that Lusambo is not my spokesperson. We don't yet have a spokesperson in the party. So the official spokesperson right now is our national secretary. And so until we have a new spokesperson. So Lusambo is his own man. He speaks what he feels in his heart. And I think that there are many, many sessions I've had with him to counsel him on things that I felt were going wrong. But like I said, I found Lusambo in MMD playing a specific role, and he has continued to do that. And I think that where he has gone wrong, his colleagues and the office has sat him down, and I'm sure they will continue to do that. Now, the other thing that I need to mention is on the National Secretary's press briefing, where Mr. Kalabo is saying that he was very disappointed to hear Mr. Lungu speak against HH and UPND. Firstly, I want to confirm that Mr. Lungu is not the aggressor. And it's interesting how life turns. MMD was responding to UPND. It was not MMD that initiated the fight. They were responding to statements that were made. Like I've said, you've never heard me go to the media and speak about my colleague, President HH, you know, to describe something about him, his incapabilities, what I believe he cannot do. You know, I have never gone to the press, and I will never go to the press, because that's not why I'm president of MMD. My challenge is with PF when it comes to policies, because they're holding the instruments of power and affecting the lives of the Zambian people. And so I have never spoken against Brother HH. That is why I think my party was shocked that Brother HH made those comments, that they had to clear that. And they were not aggressively speaking against UPND. I think they were answering issues that were raised by UPND. So I think that we should learn to take responsibility, all of us, when we make certain statements, that you are not making statements to dead people who cannot defend themselves. And I think that that was what it was all about. And that is why I'm not talking about it myself, because it was already dealt with. And my policy is not to speak against any other opposition leader. And I will not be forced to do that. But once we are challenged or a statement is raised which is not true, our party shall defend itself. Our party shall clarify the matters. And I think it's our responsibility. And that was done. So I think that... the other questions were just contributions of zealous people that were saying that, you know, UPND is cheating itself, MMD will never come back, you know, Viva MMD, go Mumba, HH is better, and all these are issues that are coming from the ground, and we respect people's views. It's a democracy which was brought by MMD.
But oh, yes, and that man who sent a text that are you anti-disabled, he was he says he meant the statements attributed to you. Think it has to do with Mr.
Honorable Chilangwa.
Yes, yeah. Honorable Chilangwa. Yes.
You see, again, that was what that press conference was all about, to make sure that they clear that. Mm-hmm. Those people that know me, I have spent my life healing broken people. My ministry itself is a healing the sick and spending time with the underprivileged, spending time with the handicapped. Those are the people that have formed part of my fraternity and friendship. And I can say that I am one of the very few that the Handicap Society administration gave an award to after I left the vice presidency, because when I was vice president, cabinet office became the center of the handicapped. In fact, there was a complaint from the Minister of Community Development that we need to know whether the Vice President has taken over the job of being the Minister of Community Development, because the handicapped, the blind, the lame used to come to Cabinet House because they wanted to meet with me, because they knew I had a program for them. We worked on many things for the handicapped. Number one, I called ZNBC to my office when I was Vice President and insisted that they start the sign language on television so that the deaf could also listen to the news broadcast. Up to today, I see a little caption by the side of the television of somebody interpreting to the deaf. That came from my side, from my office, and I proposed that. It's still running today. So if I didn't have a heart for the handicapped, that would not happen. I went through government buildings and demanded that every government building should have a ramp for the wheelchairs, because they only had steps in most of the places. I demanded that they needed to have ramps so that the handicapped could also have access to these government facilities without too much trouble. So Dr. Kenneth Kaunda and myself in Mlungushi, when the handicapped had their own meeting, presented awards to two of us. One went to Kenneth Kaunda, the other one was presented to me. I was out of the country in the US, but the award was given to my wife to be given to me. And so anybody who says that I could have spoken against Honorable Chilangwa is being malicious. Firstly, I don't know Honorable Chilangwa myself. Two, I didn't even know Honorable Chilangwa was disabled, disadvantaged in that area. So when this whole thing was coming, I didn't know it was coming from. And Honorable Chilangwa should be comfortable to know that he's my partner, he's my friend, he's my colleague, and I'm there to support him in any way, because my whole life, my whole ministry has been spent in healing broken people and spending time with the underprivileged and trying to find a way in which everybody could have equal access to the benefits of being a citizen of this country.
Okay, I think in conclusion, let me just read out the last four text messages. Basically, I think most of them are just comments. This one says, good morning, Mr. Mumba. I think you are the one who can make a good and clean Zambia. Go forward, sir. 2016 is for MMD cause. You have good policy. This is from Aaron. This other one says, please include young people in the leadership in the party. Ignore the voices of stereotypes and narrow-minded people. This is Kawiana calling, from around Lusaka. This other one says, as MMD, we are bouncing back. Viva Mumba. This is Muzaza Soko coming through again. So, Doctor, what are your last remarks as we conclude the program?
Suffice to say to the Zambian people that we can live together. We can live in respect of one another. We are experiencing a difficult time in this country. The benefits that we had under the Movement for Multi-Party Democracy have diminished, but we should not lose hope. Our goal is to be strong, to be brave, to remove fear from us and do what is right. As the elections come, not only the by-elections, but the 2016 election, may we not be chasers of the wind. May we vote for honesty. May we vote for morality and integrity, because that is what stays. In 2011, we voted for a mighty wind that was blowing. I'm aware there are some other politicians that want to, again, artificially create winds based on the capacity of maybe what is the cliche they use or the money they use, but Zambians have learnt it the hard way. They have learnt it the hard way that it's not in the wind where the power is and reality is. It is in truth, morality, and character of leadership. Zambia shall not be saved until we identify men and women of integrity to take over the reins of this power. To the church, don't belittle yourselves. Don't always think the non-believers will make better politicians, because you have the mind of Christ and you can be used to redirect this country where we no longer just change governments, but we change politics. Politics of love, politics of reconciliation, politics of working together as a people to achieve a common goal. It's a prosperity of our country and the peace of our country. And I believe Zambia will become a center for the world to come and see what morality, integrity, and Christianity can do when allowed to function in a country. I thank you.
Doc, I really would love to thank you so much. I know you are a busy man, and for us to have you here is a great honor.
Thank you, Kunda Kunda. And to the listeners, thank you so much for staying with us for such a long time. I wish you God's richest blessings.
Thank you. And of course, this brings us to today's edition of the Platform program. Today we're discussing the MMD's wish list for power. Today's quotes, this one, all these are wise words from taken from our forefathers. From Namibia, learning expands great souls. This other one says, to get lost is to learn the way. If you close your eyes to facts, you learn through accidents. The other one says, wealth, if you use it, comes to an end. Learning, if you use it, increases. It's a Swahili proverb. The other one, the Buganda proverb says, by trying often, the monkey learns to jump from the tree. Then this other one says, you always learn a lot more when you lose than when you win. But Teke proverb says, you learn how to cut down trees by cutting them down. And the last one says, the wise create proverbs for fools to learn, not to repeat. Kunda Kunda is my name. Until next week, at the same time, you do have a blessed coming weekend. Good morning.
The Platform is a program that addresses your political, social, and economic well-being. Broadcast every Monday and Thursdays at 09 hours on Joy FM Radio 106.9 FM. Call or SMS to participate. Remember, the views expressed on the platform are not of the station, but those of either the guests or the participants. Joy FM Radio, for your ears only.